Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order, and we will start off with the invocation. I will do the invocation if you'll bow your heads, please. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for watching over us, Lord, and just help us to make the best decisions for Alamance County, Lord. Forgive us of our sins. And just watch over all the group here today, Lord, and for the Suriano family. Just be with them in their time of bereavement. And these things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Public comments are none. And right now, we will ask Sheriff Johnson to come forward and do this special presentation.
Commissioners, tonight I appear before you. It's a sad day. Today, we laid to rest one of the driving forces of the Alamance County Family Justice Center. Her dreams has become a reality for Alamance County. And we were hoping that we would be able to make this presentation before the good Lord took her away. Her family is here with us tonight, and I'm telling you, I have never met a human being quite like Joy Ammons Suriano. Her care for the people of this county, domestic violence victims, and the people in general will go untouched, I honestly believe, forever and ever. And tonight, I would like to ask you, commissioners, to help me bestow upon Joy Ammons Suriano the honor of dedicating the Alamance County Family Justice Center, the first in North Carolina, and asked if y'all would to take a vote on that support.
Do you have any questions? And this will be a plaque.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. If you would go ahead and...
I think.
Are you going to do that next? I'm sorry.
Yeah, if y'all will.
Okay, do I hear a motion that we accept? I have a motion to dedicate this to Ms. Suriano.
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
These individuals behind me here worked with Joy throughout the dream of developing the First Family Justice Center, and they hold different positions within the departments of Alamance County that is working in the Family Justice Center. And all these people gathered here tonight to honor Joy along with her family. And I would like to call her family up here at this time. All right, let me ask, does anybody here want to say anything other than what I've said?
I do.
Well, I just want to add to what the sheriff is saying. This is on behalf of the judiciary. The dream of a family justice center, which is soon to be a reality, the county commissioners were kind enough to afford us the wherewithal to make this a reality, but it had to have a dream somewhere and a driving force, and that was Joy Suriano. And on behalf of the judiciary, I thank you for dedicating that building to her memory and to all that she has meant to victims, people less fortunate, the most vulnerable of us in our community. And I just thank God that she adopted our community as hers.
Ms. Vaughn would like to make a statement.
Yes, I would. I know Joy has initiated many grants here in Alamance County, and also the grant that we now have. She didn't get it completed, but I understand that Susan Osborne and DSS did complete that for her. It shows how our county departments have meshed together and worked together. And Terry Johnson now has, you head up the Family Justice Center, is that correct, Sheriff?
No, I am just part of it.
Oh.
These individuals head all up the right. Family Justice
I was just
Center.
Trying to give you some credit.
No, thank you, I appreciate that.
But we share your loss. It is a terrible loss to Alamance County. You are in our prayers. I do also want to say that this grant has allowed the Fire Marshal's Department office to get about $50,000 for a fiber optic cable to complete their area down in the Family Justice Center. So I think it's just a fantastic thing, and we all benefit from what Joy has done, and she will be with us always.
Okay. Sheriff Johnson.
At this time, I would like to call Joe Suriano, Joy's husband, Ashlyn Emily, her daughters, Joy's mother, Joyce Ammons from Fayetteville, Joy's sister, Jane Gilchrist, and Joy's brother, Jim Ammons, up front, please, if you would. I would like to read this to you because it really, I think, sets into play everything that we have experienced and will experience in the future. It says, North Carolina's First Family Justice Center, dedicated to Joy Ammons Suriano, whose commitment to protect and improve the well-being of domestic violence survivors shall always exist within this shelter of the Alamance County Family Justice Center. Her visions will assure the safety and security of all who enter here. Presented this day, March 1st, 2010. And a bronze plaque will be put in the Family Justice Center upon its completion, but this now belongs to the family. God bless you.
Commissioners, sorry, I got to get it down where I can speak into it. Just on behalf of our family, we all know what this meant to Joy. It's been a passion of hers for years. She saw this idea. She followed it through. She worked the grants, and it's such an honor to be here. I'm sorry Joy couldn't be here to receive it, but, you know, this just shows the legacy that she's leaving here in this county, and this was her passion throughout her professional career. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is Jason Martin.
Jason, go.
Jason.
It's in the
back. Talk to you.
Woke me up.
I told y'all I didn't need this.
Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me kind of outlining the proposed amendments to the existing watershed ordinance as they were approved or recommended by the board, planning board on February 22nd at the special meeting. Before I really get into that, though, I do want to direct you down to the paragraph down at the bottom of my memo. It says the planning department has also received a recent clarification. At the request of one of the commissioners, we did double check with the Division of Water Quality regarding the deadline of the submission of the buffer ordinance. And the state did reiterate that we have to send something to them by the 10th of March. However, if the county wished to hold a public hearing, and it was the wish of the board, then we could submit something to the state after that to replace what we send in. So basically, I could send in what the planning board has recommended, and if we hold a public hearing to solicit public input and that were to change anything, we could send in something there. And so, I mean, at this point, if I'm prepared to give you a presentation tonight, but if the board wishes to hold off until the next meeting to actually hold a public hearing for me to advertise, I'll be glad to do that too.
What's the board's wishes?
Well, Jason, I think I've talked to the gentleman right here, and mm-hmm. there's questions here from the farm community as to how they're going to be affected mm-hmm. by this. And coming in, I was thinking, well, we just need to send what we had and come back with a, you know,
yeah.
whatever they're going to make us do. But I think there's a lot of questions out here that we okay. need to answer. And just with that in mind, maybe we do need to hold off and have the hearing first.
Well, we can discuss it, you know, and call it for a public hearing later.
Yeah.
But, you know, I hate to see all these people come up here for no reason.
Mm-hmm. Well, Jason can explain a lot of that.
Yeah, I can still do my presentation. Okay. I'm not asking for any board action tonight because we're not trying to amend the ordinance tonight. Okay. At that point, we're going to submit this for state comments, and then when it comes back, we would have to hold a public hearing to amend the ordinance. But I did want to...
So what you're saying is we have two choices. We can have a public hearing in 10 days or whatever, or we can send it, get it back, and then have the public hearing on what we get back.
Sure.
Well, do we need to go ahead and hear the concerns from this community?
Well, that's for the public hearing.
Yeah, I realize that.
Well,
but this is ready to be sent into Raleigh.
Yeah.
I mean, what I have is prepared to send in on the
table. Can you just go over that part for the people?
Sure, over just the agricultural questions?
Maybe some of their questions.
I'll be glad to do that.
That's my suggestion. Tim, what?
I can put a lot of the...
Well, I want to be able to have the option to vote no to what we're sending to Raleigh.
So do I.
And if you send it in before we have the public hearing and or see what all is out there, you know, it's not going
to... Can't we change it at that point?
I agree with that, Tim. I think we probably need to go that route.
And
I think it's, from what I've read, it's the biggest bunch of junk that the government has no business telling the people how to conduct their lives. They don't pay, you know, the people pay taxes because they have to. And to be run over by the government, this is a sure sign that the government is overstepping their bounds. I know it's coming from the state, but I just don't like it at all.
And Madam Chair,
do you want to go ahead and do your presentation?
Well, I can do that. To Mr. Sutton's point, that's where at the last meeting I had my intention at that time was to call a public hearing for tonight.
Right.
And then there was a...
But we didn't have anything to go on at that time because our sentiment was the same as yours, Bill. Yeah. Tell them to do with it as they please.
Well, and the initial changes that were proposed by the planning board actually ended up being more, unbeknownst to them, being more restrictive than what we have now. So
maybe you can tell us the why. Why have we got to?
Yeah, I'd like to know this line.
Because the state of North Carolina owns the Jordan Lake, period, and they bought it years ago.
Well, basically, the Jordan Lake rules, I can give you some background on it, and be glad to do that. The Jordan Lake rules, they have been signed into law now by the governor. Both the Senate and the House have voted on it, and they were signed into law. And basically, the buffer ordinance, the model ordinance that the state gave us, pretty much literally comes from the Jordan Lake rules that were approved in the law. And in a roundabout way, it is a mandate from the state onto the counties and the local governments to pass a buffer ordinance. And I will add an unfunded one. But it is a mandate from them. And I have had some phone calls from the farm community as well, and I'd be glad to give some information to our folks from the farming community here tonight. One, what you have in front of you does not apply to the agricultural community. This is pretty much for new development. And in the proposal, even in the model ordinance, it says this does not apply to agricultural operations. And in what the county, the planning board asked us to include some stronger language for bona fide farming operations. So we did. Now, that being said, there are regulations that the state will enforce on the agricultural community. And they have charged the counties with establishing a watershed oversight committee, which has had their first meeting to kind of get everybody together. Phil Ross with the Soil Conservation Office is kind of overseeing that from a staff level. And Jane Isley, who is on our planning board, has also been appointed to that. The state appoints members to that board. And I believe Frank Bell has been appointed to that as well. They're charged with establishing how the farming community, the agricultural community, can meet their loading reduction requirements, which, if I'm correct, is 8% in phosphorus and 5% in nitrogen reduction of loading. Now, I talked to both Jane and Phil, and particularly from the farmers that I've spoke with, they were cattle farmers, and they were concerned specifically with, does this mean I'm going to have to fence my cattle out of the creek? And it's a very good question. I spoke with both Jane and Phil. Neither one of them have heard any suggestions of that at this point, and as a matter of fact, they are actually hoping that Alamance County will not have to do any additional agricultural regulation for the Jordan Lake rules solely based on the fact of how many farms that have shut down in the county. And there's a lot of farmers that have already put their streams and their creeks into conservation easements. And so they're hoping that they will get credit for that, and this won't have any impact at all. So that's the approach they're taking, and trying to minimize the impact on this. And but going back to the Jordan Lake rules as a whole, there was obviously a lot of opposition from day one to the Jordan Lake rules. The Board of Commissioners, I know, passed a resolution of opposition at that time. Both county attorney and I spoke at the public hearing in Elon in opposition to the Jordan Lake rules. The county manager, I believe at the time, submitted something in opposition to the Jordan Lake rules. Every municipality in the county is opposed to the Jordan Lake rules. I jokingly said at one meeting that the state did something that nobody else could do. They got everybody in agreement on something, you know. So
good or bad,
everybody was pretty much in agreement. And without rehashing a lot of old feelings on that, that's basically the background. And I know there was a bill introduced in the state house to kill the Jordan Lake rules, for lack of better words. And then there was another bill introduced to strike a compromise, which struck out the retrofitting requirements. And that's where we're at now. To kind of give you the background, the quick, dirty, and ugly background behind it all. But I hope that the clarification I gave regarding agricultural operations and the current committee that's being put together and helps you all a little bit. I will say that I have appointed my planner, Jessica Hill, to work with that committee to keep planning informed of what comes out of that to help us with any future policy, so we know we're not running afoul of them as we try to implement our part of the Jordan Lake rules. And Phil Ross did say that to me today that those meetings are open, and he encourages farmers to come to those meetings. And the next meeting is March 15th at 12:30, from 12:30 to 3:30.
Is that in the ag room?
It is. And that's folks from Guilford County, Orange County, Alamance County, all through the Jordan watershed area.
I think Phil needs to publicize that.
He did express to me tonight his regret to not be able to be here because they actually have a board meeting tonight. So, but he did ask me to pass that along. So, but with that being said, I'll be glad to go into my presentation just on the rules here as well.
Yeah, I think from what we did at the planning board, the whole board there was in consensus that what we need to do is basically use this watershed ordinance we have. But the biggest part was reducing the penalties. So in that effect, I think that was the biggest thing we did out of that whole thing.
That's a huge change to what the state was recommending. So,
okay.
I'll be glad to.
You want some more information?
Well, I've said in the last meeting, you know, I'm getting older, and I like to look at pictures rather than words. Mm-hmm. And I asked to see some graphs of what this would do and not do.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, I want to see an average farm, what he's allowed to do now, what he's not going to be, or what he's going to be allowed to do after we pass this. Same way with somebody who owns a house out there with minimal acreage. I'd like to see what he can do now, what we're saying he can't do or can do after we pass this. Forgive me, I can't read that and decipher it. I need to see pictures.
And that's fine. And again, I'll be glad to go ahead and do the presentation tonight. And I've got copies of that here.
He's got that tonight.
How long would it take?
Maybe 10 minutes
like
at the most.
Okay. That'd be good.
There's just some pictures.
Are they in color?
Tim, the bad part is the little screams are so small, you'll never know which ones are which.
Tim, they are in color.
And I will be as brief but as thorough as possible. This is just the outline, the purpose, applicability, implementation, existing uses, the buffer requirements, diffuse flow, table of uses, mitigation, and civil penalties. That is the bulk of what you have in the ordinance. The purpose, this is coming from the actual Jordan Lake law here, to protect and preserve existing riparian buffers throughout the Jordan watershed in order to maintain their nutrient removal and stream protection functions. Applicability, this applies to all landowners and other persons conducting activities in the Jordan watershed. It shall not apply to bona fide farming operations or existing and ongoing uses, provided that the use of the existing buffer area does not change. Alamance County, currently we only enforce riparian buffers in our existing water supply watershed areas. And I'm going to put up a graphic for that here in just a second. DWQ, Division of Water Quality, implements buffer rules for the state of North Carolina, the United States, multiple jurisdictions, local units of government, meaning if we do something in a buffer area, forest harvesting and agricultural activities. The state of North Carolina shall be responsible for enforcement in all other areas of the county, excluding municipal jurisdictions. Now, I will pause on that for 1 second. The planning board initially asked that county staff enforce this in the entire Jordan watershed. And staff recommended against that, strongly against that, at the February 22nd meeting, and I'll explain why right now. This is a map of the entire Jordan watershed, one big massive watershed. The center here in the red, you see Burlington, Graham, Hall River, Elon. Those are all phase two communities, MPDS phase two communities, where they already have stormwater requirements. The blue areas that you see in Alamance County, that is your existing water supply watershed, with the exception of a small portion right here. That is the Rocky River watershed. That's also water supply watershed. Based from the mapping department, Alamance County is roughly 435 square miles. Our water supply watershed area alone is 108 square miles. If you calculate in the Jordan watershed, 99.8% of the county is in a watershed. Now, I go back to the statement of the county enforcing this in all the watershed areas. Right now, we do water supply. I know it's going to have an impact on the planning department and on our staff. And my recommendation to the planning board and my recommendation to you all as well would be, let's take this incrementally, one step at a time, because until we know exactly what the impact is, I don't know that we need additional staff, things like that. And I feel it's only appropriate to ask for that during a budget time when I can give you hard data to justify that. And this would allow us some time before the next budget cycle to be able to do that. So we would be looking at about 25% of the county as opposed to about 80% of the county. Now, what exactly is a riparian stream buffer? Here on the left is a perennial stream and the difference of the streams. Perennial stream is a well-defined channel that contains water year-round during a year with normal rainfall. Aside from a few times where there's a drought, it may run dry, most of the time it's going to have water year-round. Intermittent streams on the right, a well-defined channel that contains water for only part of the year, or a seasonal stream. Typically, they're in the winter or the spring. Now, how do we define what a stream buffer is? The state's model ordinance suggested that we use USGS quad maps, soil surveys, or another map that could be approved by the state. I have proposed in this, and the planning board has recommended that we use USGS quad maps because they're the most current maps we have. The most recent soil survey we have is from 1960. Quad maps have been updated pretty regularly since then on into the 90s. anyhow, stream buffers apply both to perennial and intermittent streams based on this, and this is a USGS quadrangle topographical map. Perennial streams are mapped as solid blue lines, and it's a little bit difficult. That's why I hope you can see that in the pictures there. But there at the top where it's pointing, there is a solid blue line. That is what would be considered a perennial stream. Down at the bottom, it's pointing right above that pond, is a dashed blue line. That would be considered an intermittent stream. There are other streams that are unclassified, which I guess the non-scientific term for those would be a ditch. But
okay.
Now, the actual stream buffer, down at the bottom on this in your presentation map, you'll see there's a 50-foot buffer that points across the bottom. This is what we currently have. We presently say there has to be a 50-foot undisturbed buffer, with the exception of routine maintenance if you have a diseased tree or something like that, so it doesn't kill the whole buffer. They can take those out and replant on perennial streams in the water supply watershed areas. What this proposal would do would change this. It would split it into two zones. Zone one being a 30-foot undisturbed vegetative buffer, which is that first 30 feet, and then zone two, a managed vegetation buffer, which allows for grading and revegetation. And that would be on each side of the stream going out from the bank, 30 feet and an additional 20 feet.
And you say we've already got the 30?
We already have 50 on perennial.
Okay.
This would change it to 30 on perennial and intermittent, okay. And then 20. So it's actually a little bit of a loosening on the perennial stream requirements, but it's adding in intermittent streams, which we're required to do by the Jordan Lake rules. And that's just the total buffer would be 50 feet. Diffuse flow requirements. Basically, diffuse flow is the evening out of the water, allowing the vegetative area to basically serve as a filter for solids. And it lets it naturally filter out any solids and pollution into a stream. Basically, what the ordinance requirements will be is that you can't run a drainage ditch directly into a creek anymore. They would have to have some sort of a level spreader or a grass strip, something like that, to filter that out. Try to put that in as simple a terms as I can, because I think even what they have is kind of... no new stormwater conveyances would be allowed through the buffers except those in the table of uses. And that brings us to that, and that should also be in your packet as the appendix. In the table of uses, this is where there was a big sticking point with the planning board. The table of uses identifies new uses within the buffer and classifies them as either exempt, allowable, or allowable with mitigation. Exempt meaning there's no authorization required as long as they follow the rules in the table. Allowable would mean that they have to have a no practical alternative determination made, and that would be made at the staff level. As opposed to sending it to a board of adjustment, and I did verify with the state, they are fine with that. And that way people aren't being tied up for ridiculous amounts of time to do development. Allowable with mitigation, basically they can't have a practical alternative and they're willing to put together a mitigation strategy. Anything that's not in the table of uses is prohibited, which initially the planning board wanted to submit something without a table of uses, which would render anything being illegal. So that's why we came back to this. Mitigation can be met one of three ways, and this was another thing that I verified with the state. Payment of a mitigation fee to the Riparian Buffer Restoration Fund or through the Ecosystem Enhancement Program, the EEP. Donation of real property or interest in real property and restoration or enhancement of non-forested riparian buffer. The location of mitigation has to be within the same sub-watershed, so basically it has to be within the Jordan watershed. And the same distance from the Jordan reservoir as the proposed impact, or closer to the reservoir, and as close to the location as the impact as possible. Okay, now, exactly how does this work? The buffer requirement, or the buffer mitigation, impact in square feet to each zone, going back to the zone 1 and zone 2 of the buffer, shall be determined by the county by adding the area of the footprint of the use impacting the buffer, the area of clearing and grading activities within the buffer, and then plus the area of ongoing maintenance corridors within the buffer associated with the use. That equals your total area of mitigation. Then within the law, they've also stipulated certain multipliers that have to be applied. In zone 1, which is that undisturbed area, you have to multiply that square footage by 3. In zone 2, you multiply it by 1.5. So to give you a real-world example, a new subdivision that disturbs greater than 150 linear feet or one-third of an acre of riparian buffer for driveway crossings. 5,000 square feet buffer impacted for the use. 9,000 square feet is in zone 1. 6,000 square feet is in zone 2. 7,500 square feet impacted for clearing grading activities. 4,500 square feet in zone 1. 3,000 square feet in zone 2. You add 9,000 plus 4,500 times 3 equals 45,500 square feet. 40,560 square feet. Mitigation required for zone 1, 6,000 plus 3,000 times 1.5 equals 13,500 square feet mitigation required for zone 2. So now when you go to your three options, first option, making a donation to the EEP, that's set by law at 96 cents per square foot. That would be $51,840 that developer would have to pay to the EEP. Donation of real property, that is roughly 1.24 acres with a minimum of 1,000 linear feet along stream and minimum width of 50 feet. And a restoration of non-forested riparian buffer, basically it would have to be 3.72 acres, and that's to do restoration, it's multiplied again by 3 based on the law. Now, going to the civil penalties portion, what you have at the top, by tying this into the current ordinance, it also sets the violations and the fines that attach, the civil penalties attached to those violations, based on what we currently have. A severe violation being $1,000 per day, a moderate being $500 per day, and then a minor violation, you know, just negligence of the law, being $100 per day. Based on the state's recommendation, it would be $15,000 per day for a negligent violation. Just, I didn't know that I couldn't do that in the buffer. $15,000 per day. Not to exceed $200,000 for 30 days. Knowingly or willingly violating will result in a Class 1 felony and or fine not to exceed $100,000 per day. Not to exceed $500,000 for 30 days. And then knowing and willingly, I'm presuming that's what they mean by knowingly, knowing and willingly violating will result in a Class C felony, not to exceed $250,000 per day and not more than $1 million per month. So the planning board, by putting this back into that, it puts the fines to, I still think an amount that gets your attention if you made a, you know, if you violated something, but that's, the planning board felt was a little bit steep. So, now that being said, that's all that I have in that presentation. I would be glad to answer any additional questions you all have. I have checked around with some of our surrounding counties as well as to what they currently have in their ordinances. I still haven't gotten a complete list of that, but I do have some of that information that I'll be glad to share with you as well. And one question that I have been asked is, financially, what will this cost us as well? I still think the great unknown is the new development ordinance itself. And that's to come in January 2011. The EMC has to review something submitted to them by DWQ. Once they review it, they will send that to the counties, much like this buffer ordinance. We'll have 6 months to review it and act on it. Then they'll have 2 months to review what we send back to them. But what I have been told so far by the state is that there will not be any minimum acreage requirements in it. That was a big concern, that we're going to have to bump everything to 2 or 5 acre minimums. And there is no built upon area requirements, but that will drive how much stormwater treatment they will have to do, meaning what type of BMPs they're going to have to put in their new developments and things like that. So I can't give you the fine details on that. That's still the great unknown, but we should know more about that. I'm hoping by summertime, as I've requested as well from the state to send us that information, a little bit further along, even as they're doing reviews at the state level, so that we kind of at least have an idea of what they're getting ready to give us.
So. Any questions?
We don't have any of Cape Fear in our county.
Not to my knowledge.
Really? No. I mean, the basin or dry.
We are in the Cape Fear Basin. All rivers in the Cape Fear.
Okay, well, that's...
That's
my question.
Yeah, but there's not any of the watershed regulations that go with that in this county.
Separate set.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Cape Fear, does that go into Jordan?
No. Honestly, I don't know for sure.
I think it flows out of the direction.
Yeah.
That's a little different.
It does.
Yeah. Well, you know, and I'm not ready to vote for anything tonight. All this myself, y'all can. I want to see more. I want you to see what the public thinks and farmers and everybody else.
Well, we probably need to set a public hearing.
That's good. But what I don't understand is if what percentage is in our county that's Cape Fear,
mm-hmm.
and versus Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what's going into the Jordan? I mean, it can't go. See my point?
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like that would minimize somewhat of the acreage. It looks like to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just shooting from the hip here. And trust me, I don't know. I mean, but I'd like to see the figures.
I can look into it. I'd be glad to do that.
Arlington's probably got all that information. Harold Owens has probably got it.
I'll check with him.
Todd may know the answer.
It all is. The Jordan watershed is part of the Cape Fear watershed.
Right.
Everything that goes into Jordan leaves Jordan and continues to the Cape Fear.
All right, we're back from here to there, though.
It's different. It's different tributaries.
The county that's in the Jordan watershed is also in the Cape Fear watershed because it all goes. Cape Fear is the last river basin system.
Right.
Yeah, it runs to
it's like a big funnel.
Everything that's in the Jordan watershed is also in the Cape Fear watershed.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a big funnel going down through.
Yeah, the I understand basin. That point, but I won't belabor it here, but I do want to see some more figures.
Okay.
So, what are our options tonight to set a public hearing or to send this in?
I would make a motion that we set a public hearing for our next meeting.
Yeah, and I will reiterate, I do have to give the state something by the 10th of March. But, like they said to me, that they would accept something as a replacement as long as we do it within a reasonable time frame. And by that, I would presume they understand we would want to possibly hold a public hearing and then something come out of that. Yeah, they've got 6 months to review this. If we were to get something within 30 days after the 10th, I don't think it would be an issue.
So we have to have something by the 10th.
Yeah, I've got to give them something or we're in violation.
Send them a note
so.
And tell them it's on the way.
Well, and they know.
I think Jason is suggesting that we send them this at this point.
Yeah, and we're not bound to it, though. We can always change.
Yeah, I mean, it can be changed even if
as long as we
send
we don't
it.
Adopt it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we have
here locally.
We have
right.
There has to be a public hearing before we can adopt an amendment anyway.
Well, we have a motion on the floor to set a public hearing.
Yep.
So we need to do that one first, and so I have a motion.
I'll second.
Have a second.
Okay.
All in favor?
Uh-huh.
And that will be at our next meeting. Now we need to give it some consensus or have a motion for Jason to send this through. To the state, is that right?
Subject to public hearing.
Let's ask our county attorney.
We call it our unrevised preliminary plan.
Tentative.
Unrevised. You're going to revise it in 10 days.
Okay.
So you just
call it an
unrevised tentative plan.
Yeah.
And send it to them.
As just as a draft.
Right.
Okay. I can mark a draft and send it.
I'll make a motion that we send it as
a second.
What's that?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
that works over here.
Mr. York, if you will come forward, and we're looking so forward to this. No, we are, and I appreciate you so much. Thank you.
Good evening. Good evening. North Carolina General Statute 105-369A requires that the tax collector report to the governing body the total amount of any unpaid taxes for the current fiscal year there are liens on real property. Upon receipt of the report, the governing body shall order the tax collector to advertise the tax liens by publishing each lien at least once in a newspaper having general circulation within the county. This year, we'd like to recommend that we publish on March the 16th in the Burlington Times News, March the 17th in the Mebane Enterprise, and March the 18th in the Alamance News. As of February the 19th, when we put the report together, we had liens totaling $4,577,302.26. And some really good news. As of today, we're down to $3,804,887. So our collections department collected $772,241 last week, which is fantastic. Some more good news. We are 1% ahead collections over last year at the same point. So we're now at 93% of total collections. Last year it was at 92%. Also, we're up 5% on registered motor vehicle collections. We're at 80% as opposed to 75% last year. So that's some good news. We did 959 garnishments during February, and we collected $83,201 through debt set off.
Anybody have any questions for Mr. York? Well, thank you, Gerald. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I haven't been knowing him a long time. Call him Gerald.
Now, do we need to make a motion to advertise those?
You need to have a vote on the advertising.
Okay. Yeah, we need. I'll make a motion that we do advertise that.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, next is Mr. Haygood.
Good evening. I have an item for your consideration tonight that will require action from the board. 1992 in January of that year, Alamance County leased athletic fields at Ian Holt Elementary School. And in that same year, February of 1992, the county sublet those fields to the Alamance Civitan Club for operations for youth athletic programs through our department. Civitan Club, since that time, have made numerous improvements to the field and have been operating it as their responsibility. There is currently a lease between Alamance County and the Alamance Burlington School System for those fields that is good until the year 2017. And there's also a sublease between Alamance County and the Civitan Club that is also good until 2017. However, I have a request that was put in your package. Upon request by the Alamance Civitan Club, they have asked that this lease be terminated, sublease be terminated. What this means, as you can read, they're asking for the county, through our department, to take over operations of the field, pay the bills, maintain the property at Ian Holt Elementary School. As terms of the lease require, they have to submit that in writing to the Board of Commissioners. There's also a memo in there from me to the club clarifying a few points, which they've also seen. So I'm here tonight to ask for you to consider the Civitan Club's request to terminate the sublease of the E.M. Holt properties. And again, this would mean that that property, those athletic fields, will fall under our department's management and operations. I don't know if you have any questions. I'd be happy to try to answer.
What money? How much money is this going to be from your rec?
We would take on having to provide field supervisors for the property during baseball, softball, and football games. We would be responsible to pay for all field lights and security lighting. We would become responsible for all the operational costs, which include keeping the restrooms outfitted with all the toiletries that it needs, trash. We would also become responsible to visit the field on a daily basis. I don't know if you've ever seen that complex. Very large, right on Highway 62, right outside Village of Alamance. We would be looking at, and what we figured in our budget that we've submitted to Mr. Honeycutt, about $15,000 that we'll have to put toward the operations. Also, the property is needs approximately $39,000 in capital work right now. And we've also figured another $4,700 that we would like to try to allocate in year, fiscal year 2011-12 to do some work out there. The $39,000 includes a new building that would house some electrical equipment. There's a tremendous amount of electrical equipment on that site for all the field lights. It's currently in a former concession stand. It really should be replaced. And we figured that there's going to be some need to replace the infields on those ball fields pretty soon. But what we've tried to do is rearrange our allocations in a way that we can take on this $15,000 and run this field. It is heavily used. As I say, it's probably the nicest rural field that we have. This is the trend for the volunteer clubs that have been running our properties for years. This has happened at Saxbah Hall. We've had to take that field on back in 2006. And then in 2007, we had to do the same thing at Sylvan Elementary. We've gone from being a department that managed no sites for probably 30 years, just did administrative work, to managing numerous properties. It is pushing us to examine our staffing responsibilities and how we spend our money, too. But in this case, this is a very nice property that the Civitans did a fantastic job. I do not want you to misunderstand our gratitude to their club. They've served the community for years there, did a wonderful job, have built a model complex. It's just at this time, they felt it was in the best interest of the club to return it back to the county.
Any more questions or comments?
Now, will they do the concessions still?
Yes, we've met with the Civitans several times. They've requested to be able to continue to do the concessions at the field, which we is fine with our department. That means that we don't have to try to staff that facility or order product. It does mean the Civitan Club does retain all proceeds. That's the arrangement that we are proposing to you this evening. I think that, you know, the Civitan Club is always at Alamance and all the ones we work with, and we work with numerous ones, Hallfields, Lakeview, all over the county, and they're very supportive of our programs. The Civitans at Alamance indicated that they would, of course, continue to want to try to give back to the community. They would like to be able to do that through their concessions. We certainly wouldn't have a problem with it. We would actually prefer that some other entity operate those concessions.
Is there a possibility of funds coming, though, to cover cost of the concession?
Yes, I think what we could do, what I would recommend to the club and to the board is that if you vote tonight to go ahead and terminate the sublease, then we'll need to come up with an agreement between our department and the Civitan Club for the operations of the concession stand that I would return to you to do. But it's really a separate deal than what we're talking about tonight. They've indicated they would like to do that, and they've indicated they would like to retain the funds. But if the board feels that there may be some other arrangement you want to enter into with them, it is the option of the board. We would draft some kind of agreement between the Civitan Club, bring it back to you for review before we
let them. Well, maybe we could get a percentage for.
Yeah, that's somewhat. I mean, just to cover like.
How River does.
Are you saying that it's going to cost $15,000 for supervision and lighting and so forth per year?
Yes, ma'am.
And then we need to spend another $39,000 for capital improvements out there. Is that necessary now?
No, I think the $39,000 we put in a capital improvement plan that we've given to the county. It includes improvements that need to be made. And what we do with our capital improvement plan is we start noting these needs. These are the ones that we're aware of right now. We believe within the next 4 to 5 years, we're going to have to replace those infields out there. We also believe that as soon as possible, something should be done about the area where the electrical transformer equipment is stored at, too. But I don't see those. The $39,000 is in the capital plan. The county would work with us and you to determine when it would be feasible to fund those expenses. The $4,750 in needs for the field, what we are trying to do is set ourselves up to where we do a rotating set of repairs. We run fields at Beaver, Jordan, Sylvan Athletic Club, and also Sylvan Elementary and E.M. Holt. And we're trying to start off, we'll start off this year at Saxbah Hall is what we're proposing to do at Beaver, Jordan, go in there and make improvements through our operating budget. Next year, if we continue to get those funds, we'll transfer those monies to E.M. Holt. Then the third year, we would go to Sylvan and try to do it through our operating fund. So the operation money is about $15,000. Yes, those will be new expenses for our department in order to run this field the way it's been run before.
Any other questions or comments?
before they took the concessions, if I'm not mistaken, and they did the whole operations of all the monies that they took in at the concessions and operated that field. Why don't we make a motion or make a play to them that we would half the proceeds that come in there, half to them and half to the county? That will cut our cost and be fair to them.
Some kind of percentage, yeah.
Yeah.
A 50-50 split.
And we can certainly do that. We can come back to the Civitan Club with a proposal based on your desires. And again, if you, the memo that I sent to them says we would, this agreement's terms would follow what is defined in the original letter, is separate. This agreement for concessions will be separate from the lease. Uh-huh. So if you think it's reasonable to terminate the sublease, which I don't believe we really have much of a choice, then our next step, if you approve that, will be to draft something that we would send to Mr. Honeycutt's office and to Mr. Albright for them to review, and then give those terms for the concession operations to Civitan Club. And if the consensus is to ask the club to split the proceeds with the county, we would certainly put that in there and get a read from them. Are they willing to do that? Would they do that? And then if they're not interested in doing that, and it's a deal-breaking point, we would come back to the board and say, look, they really want to try to retain the money. Now, please understand, and understand, too, that they have been clear to us to say they want to continue to be involved at this field. I truly believe their desire is to use proceeds from the concessions to continue to help out there. I think this move of terminating the sublease, though, will mean that the operations, the ongoing bills will be paid by our department. I wouldn't want it to be misunderstood. There's no effort here by the Civitan Club to use it to generate money for anything else other than they probably would wind up doing something with the community. But we can certainly put a proposal to them to say, you split half the funds with the county.
Well, the first thing we need to do is relinquish this.
I'll make that motion that we terminate this lease with the Civitan Club.
I have a motion and a second to terminate the lease.
I think we may be getting ahead of ourselves if we do that. And
well, we got to.
Basically, I know we'd have to do that. But
he's going to do a draft after that.
Okay.
Yeah, and then we'll come back with it.
Okay. We just need to do this first, okay?
To release.
I don't think anybody up here is against the athletics and so forth as far as your area is concerned. I think what we're trying to do is just tighten our belts all the way around and, in every department, but still have the youth out there to play ball and et cetera. It's,
we've been very fortunate in Alamance County that for 30-plus years, the communities have run the fields. In fact, until 2006, we didn't run a single field. But I think the volunteer clubs, the trend we see, not everywhere, but oftentimes, is they're cyclical. They'll grow and they do a wonderful job, and then if their lead supporters move or go to another facility, they'll start to wane. I think today it's very difficult to find people who are able to commit the many hours that have been committed to EM Holt. I can tell you that if you've been, you can see the amount of work that's been done there since 1992. It's quite phenomenal for a club to do that. It just becomes more difficult. It becomes financially taxing. So I agree. I think what we're trying to do also is figure out how to lessen the impact of our budget, how to use existing staff that we have to make sure that this field can continue to be used, but not put a strain on the budget. Too.
Okay, I have a motion and a second on the floor to terminate the lease. All in favor? Okay, and now we would like to, we need a motion to.
Do we need a motion or just a suggestion? Yeah. I think it's basically.
Well, I can go from here based on what I've heard from the board this evening and approach the Civitan Club and let them know that we would like to discuss further terms of the concession explain to them that there is a desire to split proceeds.
He's there, free popcorn.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian.
Every other Monday night.
Yeah.
Okay, at this time we have county manager reports.
Thank you.
This good news or bad news?
Fair news.
Fair news.
I'll take fair over bad news any day.
Okay.
All right, thanks. Tonight, as we've discussed before at our last meeting, is we kind of need a map and a guidelines and framework of where we're going on this year's budget, but also begin looking at next year's budget. What we have done in this report and in this presentation is really look at worst-case scenarios with respect to revenue. Our major goal and what we would like to recommend to you from staff is we have to reverse the trend of using our fund balance. As you know, we used about over $3 million in last year's budget and fund balance. If we don't reverse the trend now, we may use $2.9 million, even more than that, if the revenues are not what they're supposed to be. Our suggestion right now is how we can do things to reverse that trend, to get us on good financial standing so we can move forward into 2010-11 fiscal year budget.
Do we have copies of that?
No, I will get it to you. I finished it up at about 3 o'clock this afternoon, so we've been working on it, trying to give you as accurate figures as possible. Here's just a quick overview. Current budget shortfall issues. Appropriated fund balance. We used $2.9 million in this year's budget to balance off our budget. And as we've talked about before, normally that's not an issue because our expenditures are usually down, revenues are usually up, it usually balances out. However, in the economic times that we've had, it's not balanced out. So we have had to use the full amount of fund balance. Again, last year it was $3.1 million. This year, if we don't do any changes, it may be $2.9 million. And again, we need to reverse that trend. Revaluation in the hole. Is $1.731 million. As we've talked about before, in looking at our budget and setting the tax rate last year, we looked at trying to set a revenue neutral figure. And I've got a couple of slides that kind of show what our original thoughts were back in February, March of last year and what they actually are now. But if we look at it, is $1.73 million in the hole. All other revenue shortfalls are about $1 million. That includes investment income, fees and services. So if we add up all those other revenues, we're about $1 million in the hole. So we're $5.631 million. And again, this is worst case scenario. You know, if nothing comes in above what we projected on revenue. Current budget issues. We've looked at some solutions. Right now, we've looked at a voluntary 2% departmental budget cuts. Right now, we've received $1,017,000 in that. Adjust insurance rates. That's a reoccurring expense of $1,008,000, and I will go over that a little bit more in detail in a little bit. Payroll savings through 630 is $2.4 million. This is from frozen positions that we've had, and also we've had lag time with respect to filling positions. We believe that there will be a $2.4 million savings in overall payroll.
How many employees is that? How many positions is that?
I knew you would ask, and I left it in
his office.
In the office.
We've got somewhere between 6 and 7 that have been frozen for the whole year, and we've got about 12 positions, 12 to 15 that are empty right now.
18, 20.
All right. But that's
they must make good money.
But there's also a lot of lag time as far as those positions not being filled.
Remember, so it's just 20 positions, though, roughly.
20 positions right now, yes, sir. Again, right now, those total savings are 4.497. Additional savings is use of designated fund balance. We designated funds over the years that we've not used. You know, if we look at part of our fund balance, there's a lot of designated line items that we have not used. We feel like we can clean up some of that, and that would be $250,000. We possibly could look at some additional cuts. That would be $383,000. And then we have not heard yet from the LME or the school system. So those cuts are not included. You know, any possible return to our budget is not included at this point. So if we did that to this point, that would be $5.131 million. And again, that's about $500,000 less than what we were looking for our overall $5.6 million. Just to give you an idea of what we've cut, these are the cuts that we have seen from the county manager's office, you know, to recreation, jail, sheriff's department. So we have had very good participation from all the departments. And again, this was done past mid-year. And we've had a lot of things have been encumbered already. A lot of departments have already spent a lot of their funding. So this is what we've got with about 60% of the year already passed.
Could I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
What departments didn't cut anything? Or is that all of them?
That's all of them except for the school system and the LME. Yeah, we have question marks for the schools.
I understand that. I was talking about inside.
Inside, everybody is cut.
Okay, because last time we talked, not everybody had it.
But ACC has already responded.
ACC did respond. We did get $15,000 that they said that they could cut, which was, I think it was 0.75%, but it was still a you know, they're tight with their enrollment increasing by 15%. So I did appreciate the work that they did as well.
I hate to belabor this, but can you go back to the first slide? Okay, the two, where is it? Is that the first line? Okay, there. The 2.9 appropriated, now that's what we had in the budget for 910, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that was...
Right.
So we're not really short that if we put it in there.
Exactly.
Right.
But I'm saying we're short so we don't have to use fund balance.
I understand.
Yeah. So we, you know, this is, again, worst case scenario. Yeah. Again, we'll go back to our fund balance challenges. In 2008-09, we had a general fund unreserved fund balance of $18.142 million. And again, we budgeted in this year's budget, 910, $2.9 million worth of use. Remember, though, that $500,000 of that was for Grand Manor. So just to cover the budget shortfall was $2.4 million. The goal that we have for the remainder of the year is no use of fund balance. We're trying to do everything we can to stop and reverse that trend. So our goal is not to use any fund balance. Our goal for 10-11 budget is limited to no use of fund balance. So we're going to do everything we can not to use fund balance again. Again, try and reverse that trend and get us on a more positive footing with respect to our fund balance.
So if can you go back? If you got 18.1 and you got 2.9 budgeted for 910, you're saying that we would end the year with three, right at 15?
Well, it would be less. I've got a couple of slides.
You covered that.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry to.
Oh no.
Jump ahead.
You're fine, and that's kind of a good segue. This is the trends, our fund balance history for the last 7 years. As you can see, overall, we're at the lowest at 21.22% that we've been in 7 years. But that is reserved and unreserved. You know, reserved is by state statutes. Unreserved includes some of our, reserve fund balance and our encumbrances. And then we have that broken down. Again, what we have available for budget is really not the 18.1 million. We would only have the 10.91 million. That's the undesignated. That's money that's not been encumbered. That's money that's not been reserved for anything else. That's money that kind of we have in our piggy bank. But as you can see, that's the lowest it's been in 7 years. So if we continue and we didn't do anything right now and we had to use $2.9 million, you know, we'd be down to $8 million in undesignated, and that's really not acceptable. So that's really what we're trying to stop, and our big concern is the undesignated fund balance. You know, a lot of it's reserved for state statute, you know, the minimum 8%, but that's the only thing that we can use is a 10.91 million. So does that answer your question? Again, the use of the employee health insurance fund. One of the things that we've talked about, and we have also talked about this with our auditor as well, if you look at the county, and again, we are self-insured, we have a current fund balance as of July 1 of last year of $7.6 million. And if we don't do anything, we will have another $2.4 million that will go to that fund balance by year end. And again, that's what we're projecting. So that would be $10 million. And that's more than what we need to be in that fund. I can't remember how many years ago it was that the county raised the insurance premium rate from $400 to $500 to build back up the insurance fund. Well, we've done a good job, and that's one of the positive things about being self-insured is you can adjust those rates back and forth. You know, you get to the level you need to be. If you need that money, you can take it back and change the premium amount. Again, currently we pay $500 per month for an employee. We would make a recommendation to the board that we lower that amount back to $400 per month and make that retroactive to July 1 of last year, which would save us $1.08 million in our current year budget. But that would also give us $1.08 million in next year's budget as far as revenue that we could use.
Did the insurance guy endorse that?
He did. We also met with the insurance committee as well and went over the figures, and the insurance committee made that as a recommendation as well. We've talked a lot about revenue neutral. And, you know, I've stated 2.5 cents as our revenue neutral rate, and that was a floating figure. What I wanted to do is give you kind of where we had where we budgeted at in April of last year, and then what we're actually at in February of 2010. Again, our tax levy for 2008-09 was $63.6 million. So revenue neutral rate would give you that same amount. So we looked at, with the reval and assessed value, this is what we budgeted of $12.468 billion, then times 51.07, or .5107, that gives you $63,679,212. That's your revenue neutral figure. If you add growth in there, you know, we do get the growth that occurred over the year. We budgeted growth at 2.54%. So that would have been an additional $1.6 million in growth that would have been on top of the revenue neutral. If you add the growth in to the revenue neutral tax rate, that was your 52.37 cent tax rate. And if you remember, when we did our budget, we said we felt like that 52 cents, you know, yes, it's a little bit under revenue neutral, but we felt like 52 cents was a good number to work with and a good number for the board to budget for. But again, remember our assessed value of $12.468 million is what we budgeted. This is actual as of February 2010. The actual assessed value is $12.1 billion, which is a difference of $344,240,584 in assessed value. And again, a lot of that has to do with the appeals from the reval and the Board of Adjustment. And one of the things about that, the system worked. You know, if people had concerns and problems with respect to their tax valuations, the system worked because, again, we were under budget by $344 million on assessed valuation. Again, if we use the $12.1 billion times 52.5252, that gives you your revenue neutral rate number of $63,679,000. Again, does not include growth. If we add the growth back in of the $1.6 million, the actual revenue neutral rate with growth included is .5386. So that's where our revenue neutral rate number is And just an FYI, 1 cent of the tax rate is approximately $1.21 million. Is there any questions so far? Okay. Changes to expenditures. Again, as we talked about, we asked for a 2% reduction back the first part of February. Again, difficult to ask when almost 60% of the year was over. Projected cuts, again, if we got the full 2% in for all internal and external agencies, other than nonprofits, we did not go back to the nonprofits and ask them for a cut, was $2.2 million. Again, current cuts received, approximately $1.1 million. Again, we've not received any notification from the school system or the LME yet of anything that they plan to do as far as cuts. But I did have a good conversation with Dan Hahn, and Dan's going to carry that to his board, I think, in the next couple of weeks. So, and again, what does this mean for next year? You know, we got to get in a good shape and get ready for next year. We got some new challenges. You know, county government does not stand still. There's new costs that are involved that we have to deal with. There's budget shortfalls that we're going to have to deal with. As we have talked about before, we have new additional debt service, which will be $1.2 million. This year, in our 9-10 budget, there was $250,000 budgeted for the Group A projects for our debt service. So if we add all that together, you know, the new for Group B for the full year and a full year for Group A is an additional $1.2 million. So that's new expenditures we have to come up with. Again, we're $1.69 million short in revenue neutral, you know, if we were wanted to be revenue neutral. So that's a shortfall. New security costs for civil courts. As you're aware that we've not had any security downstairs at the civil courts. Part of the renovations that we have done included security. You know, we've gotten a scanning machine that will be donated. Tim's been working really hard on that. The sheriff has as well from the U.S. Marshals Service, I believe, and appreciate the sheriff doing that. We have that equipment coming in, but that was a big concern with the judges, was not having any security in that building. So we have met with Blankford Security. They have preliminary given us a cost of between $80,000 and $90,000 worth of new costs to secure this building with security. Again, as we've talked about before, probation rental charges, one of those other unfunded mandates by the state. We have to pick up all probationary charges and rentals. So a full year of that additional is another $75,000. Mandatory state retirement increases for employees. The actuaries are low. State retirement for the employer is going to go up for the first time, I think, since 93. But what does that mean for us? That means another $500,000 of unfunded mandate that we have to fund. One of the things we've talked about in the budget prep with our department heads is we've asked for basically no new employees, no new programs. One of the things that we are looking at is an occupational health nurse that we would fund out of the health insurance fund and workers' comp. We believe in the long term that will actually save us money from our workers' comp claims. But that's something, you know, as far as new that we're looking at. Another challenge is employee raises and salaries. Right now, we're not looking at increasing salaries as of July 1, but if we don't do that, it will be 24 months since an employee received a cost of living raise. One of the things that we're suggesting is maybe to place 2% aside and budget for that, and then relook at it and put that in a salary contingency. Relook at salaries, relook at revenues like sales tax to see if we're picking up, you know, above where we're supposed to be. See how we're tracking at mid-year. If we're tracking fine, it'll be the board's decision whether to give rate, you know, to give the cost of living or not. If we're not tracking fine, we're not out of it. So that's an option to consider this coming budget year. What's next? We have our first budget retreat on April 5th. It will be in the morning, so a month from today. And the other thing is, we need kind of feedback from you to see if we're going in the right direction. If we're going down the road you want us to go, don't want to be in left field when you want us in right field. But immediately, the thing that we would need from you is approval from the commissioners to retroactively lower the individual insurance premium the county pays per full-time employee from $500 to $400. And again, that would be retroactive to July 1, 2009. And with that...
Can you go back to the first slide again, please?
What?
There you go. There you go.
Yeah.
Well, second slide.
Okay. That LME does not meet after our next meeting.
Yeah.
All right. Of all the cuts that we've totaled up there, how much of those are reoccurring or could be? And versus how many are one time and obviously can't be?
What I've got here at the bottom is reoccurring expenses is R and non-reoccurring is the N.
Can you give me a figure there? Where are we?
I haven't added one. See,
where are we? Okay, N's is non-reoccurring, one time, right?
Yes, sir.
So I said 2.4.
The 2.4 would be non-reoccurring, you know, depending upon.
And the 2.1.
ABSS or the LME would be non-reoccurring. The designated fund balance, you know, also if we cleaned up some of that, that's also a non-reoccurring. Again, this is worst case scenario. Gerald told you some good news. You know, we're tracking better on our collections. You know, we're up. And I appreciate work, Gerald. I appreciate the work that Gerald's done. One of the things when Gerald became tax collector, Amy and I had a very good conversation with Gerald and said that's got to be a priority. We've got to find the money somewhere. And I appreciate the work Gerald and his staff has done. Done a wonderful job and been great to work with. Sales tax. Sales tax is not bad. Sales tax is about at budget. You know, if we continue to see an upturn on that for the rest of the year, you know, sales tax could be a little bit better. Again, this is worst case, but I would rather give you worst case than coming back in May and saying, oh my gosh, we're messed up and we got to have a 10 cent tax increase.
Well, I have to be honest about it. If the American people do not understand the error that we're in right now, they'll never understand. And it comes all the way down to the local level. We don't have an option, in my opinion, but to stop the bleeding of our fund balance. And the only way to stop the bleeding of it is to do what you're doing. Unless you believe the economy was going to just take off next year and the next decade and everything was going to increase. And it's just not going to happen.
Well, we are hoping a little bit. And again, Tanger should be in October. And Tanger will bring us, you know, if you look at their projections, I believe they said one time in the paper, it'll be about $7 million on property tax and sales tax that will generate to the county. Again, that's a hope. We may budget a little bit, but we ain't budgeting $7 million for it.
No, that's so, 2 years away, yeah. Probably.
They're supposed to be it, so you can go shop there next Christmas.
Yeah, but you'll have some lag time there.
Yeah, there will be, especially on the property tax. You saw a year away from that, but you're hoping that the sales tax would bump up just a little bit if we can get some of those college kids to shop out.
But it's going to take away from the mall. Yeah. That's the bad thing. But you can make us happy.
Yes, I am. And again, I apologize for not having your packet. It was one of those things that we worked on till basically 4 o'clock this afternoon. And I do appreciate the work Amy has put in this as well. I've about lived in her office for the last couple of weeks, and I appreciate, you know, the work Susan's done as well. So we've hopefully we've got a plan to move forward, and if the board's agreeable kind of with the direction we're going, when you see the preliminary budget in April, it will be based a lot upon what you're seeing right now.
Is there anything we can do to encourage the schools to participate in this?
Let's ask them.
I think they are going to do something.
Right, right. We're hoping, and I've had some good conversations with Dr. Bridges, but I think they're looking at some things as well. So I'm very hopeful that they'll work with us on this as well, and we appreciate that also.
And did you hear me say the LME does not meet until after our next meeting?
Yeah. All right. That'll be fine, but I do appreciate Dan as well. You know, Dan has been very good with this. The only thing right now, I guess, if the board is agreeable, is to make the motion to retroactively change the health insurance from 500 to 400 as of July 1.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. I do have one other thing for you. One of the things that you asked about at the last meeting is, especially when we talked about our facilities planning, is you as a board need to know what we've got coming up, what's regular maintenance and what needs to be replaced. In front of you is a booklet of our facilities, and if you just turn over to any page and look on the back, it's broken down: HVAC, electrical, plumbing, roofing, carpet, floor and tile, ceiling, painting, interior and exterior, and fire detection. And it's looked at routine maintenance and replacement. And we have that broken down 0 to 2 years, 2 to 5 years, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, and then on further. Richard and his staff has done a wonderful job in getting this together in the past couple of weeks. Especially with trying to move the clerk of court to youth services. So they've had a lot on their plate, but hopefully this will give us a better idea when we start look at budgeting and planning, that we can address some of these needs quicker than waiting for a $10 million facilities improvement plan. So if you have any questions or need any additional information about this book or let us know on that, and we'll try to get you that information.
I really commend Richard and his people for doing
really,
this.
That's good.
It's fantastic.
They really did. And again, I really want to thank them again for the work that they did on the clerk of courts and moving. And that was a yeoman's job, what they have done, and making sure that the phones and the computers and the desks, and they were ready for work this morning. So they worked over the weekend. Families worked over the weekend. The clerk of court's office has been wonderful to work with. Easy move. At least on mine, I didn't lift a box. So it made life simple, but they really did.
It has went well.
Hunt said he was so sure he couldn't hardly move.
Yeah. So. I talked to Hunt, though, and he said it did go well.
It went real well.
Okay, we'll move on to the consent agenda. Does anybody want to pull anything off the consent agenda? Not. Do you want to make sure we set the consent agenda?
So
have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any comments from the commissioners?
Yeah. Tom, help me with something here, if you will. We pulled off, it's in our packets tonight, 2008 local school finance study done by the public school forum. How long has the county been receiving supplemental funding being considered low wealth?
Is that it's a number of years, Jim. I don't know when it started.
Really?
Been, gosh, just before I got on the board, I believe.
We had been classified low wealth that long. What gets us in a category of not being a low wealth? Because I don't.
There's a formula, Tim, and it, I mean, it's based on total compensation related to total population, but I don't know which compensation they pull from. But we can get you that information.
Yeah, I wouldn't. Again, I didn't realize we were considered low level. But what's interesting, if you look at these charts, I get blasted for showing these stats a lot, but you know, if you look at this, and I had to get out a magnifying glass to take a peek at this one. The last one was in a book a lot bigger. But it showed Alamance County, the only bad ranking, in my opinion, the bad ranking was the 74th ranking of where they had Alamance County 74th, but it was in the category of where people were getting supplemental funding as a result of being low wealth. And we don't get as much as a lot of others in a lot of that analysis. But they had us down as being 52nd out of 100 systems and counties looked at on real estate. In other words, if you took the value of the real estate valuations and divided by the number of students, as if that was supposed to show some ratio of how much money that you could take, possibly, we were 52nd. But if you went into the other charts and looked at the ability, we were ranked to be 45th ability to pay into the system, and in actual effort, we were 45th. So our ranking was exactly, as far as effort, exactly the same ranking as what our ability was according to this chart. I don't know if there's any distortions there or not. Frankly, I didn't think it put us in a bad light at all. You know, the only consideration, could we do better? Also, if you looked at the chart, there was, man, I misplaced it here. Hold on one second. I would like to say it, make a comparison. There were, it's right there in front of me. There, if you look at the chart there of systems our size or 4,000 students or better or lower than us, and I thought 4 was fair, and not to go to 5, and there weren't that many more that were 5, but I cut it off at 4, and I didn't do it to come out with better results at all. I just felt like that was fair. I want to keep it 1,000 below what the original Burlington system was before we merged. But there were 7 systems that were below us in per pupil funding that was our size, or 4,000 give or take. And there were 5 above us, and of the 5 that was above us, that were above us, 1 was right there with us, to where the difference was only 20 some dollars per pupil difference. So really, as far as any real marked increase of per pupil funding of systems our size, there were really only 4, in my opinion, 4 out of counting us, 4 out of 8, I mean 4 out of 12, which I thought was, again, not a bad analysis. Not to say we can't do better, but these figures are very interesting, and I think, don't you think public school forms as fair as anybody?
They're very consistent over the years.
Yeah,
and we have always ended up there in that 50th percentile, give or take 5, like you quoted, 5, that's where we've always been.
But those are good. Is 2008, is that report the last one that you know of?
We just got one, Tim. I don't know when y'all received that.
But we just got off the internet. They usually sell it. They usually don't give it away, and this one was on the internet.
Yeah. Okay. It normally lags about a year.
Okay. Tom, did we get this report from you?
The school system got it. I don't know if Dr. Bridges forwarded it to Craig or not. I'm not sure.
We don't have it.
Well,
Friday mail.
Yeah.
My request is, can this be enlarged? I too had a magnifying glass and got a terrible headache trying to read it, and I did read it. I'm not sure. I'm not going to tell you. I really enjoyed the reading because it just.
Our copying department downstairs made us copies several years ago, but they made copies of the hard copy book that I got from the school system. See, Public School Forum sells that report. We used to sell it for $8, and I just wasn't going to pay $8 for it, so I was trying to get it free, and the school system got a copy of it, and they let me have it, and then I brought it over to our copying people downstairs, and they made big copies. It was a whole lot easier to read. So. But this came off.
First grade print, but you know, just.
Yeah, well, this came off the internet, and I don't.
I do appreciate it.
We can see it. Thank you.
I'm okay with mine.
Yeah, don't change it now, but you know, in the future.
But I will check on that supplemental funding formula.
Okay. Any other announcements? If not, we are adjourned.
Brian, how are you?
Good.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.